Coming up next, Webster.
Good morning. I have a couple of special missions this morning. And the first one is to find out from Dave Stupich, who is a funnier man than I thought he was, where he got the 1,667 brick shares, which he impertinently, perhaps, tendered to one of Bennett's boys in Victoria yesterday as payment in full for the very serious libel judgment against him by Premier Bennett, $10,000 on Scotch and Cornflakes. We all remember the Scotch and Cornflakes caper, which ended up in court and in which Mr. Stupich was nailed. We'll be talking to Mr. Stupich later this morning about where he got the shares and what he thinks are really worth today anyway. The other thing I must do this morning was last week I interviewed some of the principal leaders of the Aboriginal groups in British Columbia. I found it very hard to take them seriously. And I'm just going to refresh your memory now, and later on I'm going to do a poll, a serious poll, a free-for-all, on if the Indians are right or wrong on this issue.
You're really going to claim Stanley Park?
Definitely.
Now, don't pull my leg.
No, we're not. It's a serious claim. Mind you, we have to strike an agreement between the Squamish people and the Musqueam people.
Why?
Overlapping boundaries, overlapping territories.
I mean, don't tell me the Squamish. The Musqueam people are going to take over the UBC.
Perhaps. They've already laid claim to that.
And your overall final claim, you'll throw in Stanley Park, even if it's only titular ownership.
False Creek, Stanley Park, BC Place.
You won't get it. I'll tell you that right now.
Well, it's there for claim and it's there for discussion, and the courts are always available.
Unless you're Jack and the Giant Killer. You're Jack and the Giant Killer. I mean, don't be daft, Judge. You're not going to get BC Place. Bennett's just putting $1 billion of our money into it.
That's why he's doing it so quickly.
I could be completely wrong. I did not take the Indians seriously. They are serious. And here's a man I'm going to take seriously this morning, and his name is Dennis McDermott. And he is the president of the Canadian Labour Congress. Represents some 2 million, and he'll probably tell us, very unhappy workers in Canada who are being trampled under the arrogant heel of the do-nothing Liberal government. At least he led 100,000 people into Ottawa a couple of days ago. Dennis McDermott, the broad view of Canadian Labour, the broad and specific troubles that lie ahead after the break. Dennis McDermott, president of the Canadian Labour Congress, is a man who sets the tone for the 2 million-odd organized trade union members in Canada. In the face of the direst predictions about recession and slump, and knowing what's happening to, for instance, the forest products industry in British Columbia, do you think Labour should be prepared to tighten its belt and cut its demands so that we can get back to some full employment and total productivity in this country?
Well, the answer to that is we've been doing that now for 5 years. The evidence shows that wages and fringe benefits have been running way behind the inflation rate, so we've already got our belt tightened back to our backbone. And we represent people, of course, who have been unemployed for a long time. We have unprecedented unemployment, and even the figures don't really tell the true story, because there are the, what I call the unaccountables, people who are not listed in the UIC statistics, and young people who have never had a job, never listed as as seeking one.
Give or take a few hundred thousand, we've got about 1 million unemployed in this country. But it's not yet visible on the West Coast, and it would seem to me, Mr. McDermott, that certainly the big union settlements in British Columbia, especially the government unions, OTEU and all these other people who are fed by the taxpayers' money, that they've kept up to inflation are very close and sometimes a little ahead. Is that not happening in the rest of the country?
I don't think, no, it isn't happening in the rest of the country, and I'm not even sure it's happening here. Because you have to remember that the last budget brought down the former non-taxable items and fringe benefits, which are considerable, are now taxable, so that's an automatic wage cut. And when they introduced the increase in domestic energy prices that will go on now for the next 4 or 5 years, that automatically is another wage cut.
Automatic increases in home oils, heating oils, and gasoline, and all the rest of it.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
What is that? What do you predict for bargaining across the country when you get into action later this, beginning of 1982?
It's always tough, but in circumstances like this, it becomes incredibly tough. I mean, employers don't keel over in a dead faint because a union has a list of ambitious demands. When you have a climate of unemployment, when you have a climate of economic recession and the economics of scarcity, then it makes collective bargaining extremely tough.
Well, your friend of mine, Mr. McKechnie, was boasting all over the lot last week about this wonderful new budget, which is going to encourage business, benefits for certain smaller people, soak the rich. Did that make you happy?
It soaks everyone, not just the rich, and it doesn't soak the very rich, if you look at that budget closely. But no one agrees with Mr. McKechnie, and I've been traveling all across this country, meeting with a lot of people. I met with 100,000 of them the other weekend in Ottawa, including a great many businessmen and entrepreneurs and people like that. I haven't met one single solitary person or one spokesman for any organization that agrees with McKechnie's statement. That budget is an absolute disaster. It's going to bring about economic ruination in this country. And it runs counter to what they promised the people when they ran for election.
Well, mind you, the Liberals couldn't elect a dog catcher this side of the lakehead, but your people, your good trade unionists, all dedicated NDPers in the East, keep electing Tories and Liberals in large numbers, don't they?
Well, we didn't in the Spadina by-election in Toronto a little while ago. And that was considered to be a very safe Liberal seat with Jim Coutts, the handmaiden of Trudeau, picked. He got beat by a New Democrat. Recently, the good people in Manitoba made a decision. I think that's all connected with the economic idiocy and the economic stupidity that appears to be the program of the
But down you went. Magnificent organizing. How much did that cost the Canadian Labour Congress to whip 100,000 trained demonstrators into Ottawa behaving with impeccable gentleness?
Well, they weren't trained demonstrators, and that wasn't just a purely a CLC thing. As a matter of fact, there was less organic organizing went into that event than the one that we put on in 1976 when we had the day of protest. What we had here was an issue. And that demonstration was a demonstration of a coalition of people, of consumers, of women, of angry, concerned Canadians. And that's the reason why we got that number of people out. It wasn't the sophisticated organizing so much. It was because we had an issue that affects every single person in this country.
And what did Trudeau do in the face of your demonstration?
He has done nothing. He shrugs. That's what he does every time.
But how can you expect a free enterprise government, so-called, like the Liberals, to turn around and accede to your demands that he cut interest rates? You know as well as I do, Mr. McDermott, that interest rates follow the international market, and that there's no way any government in this country is going to arbitrarily put interest rates for housing down to, say, 12 or 13%.
I don't know why. They did it with wages in 76. Wages are very complex, too. They're connected with the international scene. They are connected with tariff and trade, with productivity, profitability, and so on. A very complex mechanism. But they said in 1976 it will not go above 6% by legislative edict. Don't tell me they can't do the same thing with interest rates. In Barbados, I had a businessman that was a part of that demonstration who told me, a Canadian businessman, borrowing money in Barbados at 13% because the Prime Minister of Barbados said it will not go above 13%. Not by legislative edict, just by word of mouth. Just put the word out. Now look at what happened just prior to the budget. The manipulative process brought the interest rates down. The manipulative process brought the interest rates down to accommodate McKechnie on November 12 when he came down with his so-called budget. I don't care how they do it, Jack. The manipulative process, the legislative edict, or whatever. But they've got to come down because, you know, that same government promised the people of this country. You remember the last election. The government came down under Clark because of the Crosby budget.
Right.
Okay.
Tough, honest budget.
The election was fought on economics, purely, wholly on economics. The counter-arguments to the Crosby budget. What did Trudeau and company tell the Canadian people? A, we will restrain interest rates. Clear-cut promise. Herb Gray, the Minister of Trade and Commerce, I guess, isn't he? From Windsor said, I will resign if interest rates go up.
He never did resign.
They said, we are going to do something about unemployment. They said, we are going to control energy prices. They said, we're going to create secondary industries. We're going to have an industrial strategy. All of the promises that they made the Canadian people, they have not only carried out, but what they're doing is the diametric opposite. Now that, to me, is political immorality. So they don't need me to tell them what my program is or what our program is. All they have to do is carry out the promises that they made to the Canadian people.
Well, do you think in the meantime this country is going to go down the tube and there are going to be mass foreclosures? Or do you approve this business of the banks being guaranteed for building up the equity debt for the poor households?
All that does, that's another manipulative process, and whoever devised that one, I presume it's McCacken, must think that the bulk of the Canadian people are incredibly stupid. Because all that does, all that is a guarantee for the bankers.
And here you are.
Money into the market.
You're the leader of 2 million trade unionists, and you're in effect powerless until the next election. And even then, you probably can't deliver what you want, which is an NDP government.
I'm not so sure about that, because when you look at it, I mean, we switched from one turkey to another. I mean, we had Crosby, and now we've got McCacken. We could have had Bobby Ray, for God's sakes. And I think the people of this country are going to take a good look Ed Broadbent and his New Democrats, because that is the only viable alternative that we have. I mean, if we need any more object lessons to tell us that there is essentially no difference between the Liberals and the Conservatives, the only difference is the degree of their conservatism.
Mr. McDermott, you may have a workers' philosophy in the hard-stricken places like Windsor, Ontario, where you've got thousands of unemployed. The worker out here is so affluent and so well off at the moment, the last thing he wants is socialism. Wouldn't you agree to that?
No, I won't agree to that, because socialism is
not
comfortable.
They're worried about the capital gain on their second family home under the new budget, as they happen to say.
Jack, the people in West Germany and the people in Sweden and the people in Norway and all of those countries have been under social democratic rule. They are equally affluent. They are more affluent, as a matter of fact.
Do you think we're going to go down the tube on the Liberals? Do you think that we face social unrest and upheaval if unemployment continues and there's we don't have full employment and we continue to have a Liberal or a Tory government?
Canadians are incredibly placid people, but I think that the social consequences of this are absolutely inevitable. I mean, young people, you're going to have hundreds of thousands of young people who absolutely have no future, who don't even see a job way down the tunnel. Now, that's got to bring about, and I'm not advocating it, but it's got to bring about social unrest.
Webster and Dennis McDermott, president of the Canadian Labour Congress. You'll have a chance to have at him a little later, but he's in a very modest, low-key mood this morning. Is this the real Dennis McDermott? After the break. Well, we've established one thing anyway, that Dennis McDermott of the CLC is not a Liberal supporter, not a social credit supporter, not a Tory supporter. He's a supporter of the workers.
That's right.
No.
And the party that represents the workers,
the
only party, the only party that does.
You never run for them?
No.
Well, couldn't you do that too? A guy like yourself could walk into a riding in Ontario.
I could, but I don't see that in my...
In your crystal ball.
In my crystal ball, no. I love the party, I'll work for it, I'll do anything for it, but I do not see myself as a member of Parliament.
I see that GM are laying off 13,000 more workers worldwide. What will that do to your base in the Auto Workers Union?
Wow, it's already been seriously eroded. I mean, of all the basic industries in this country, the automobile industry is the most affected because it is a basic industry. That is because people do not have the money to pay the stupidly high interest rates unless you're in a very comfortable position of making a cash outlay. And that has, of course, a very severe
economic
repercussion.
And most of us would rather buy nice, crisp little Japanese cars anyway than the Canadian clunkers.
I don't know why, because the North American car is as good as anyone you'll find anywhere in the world.
Yeah, they tell me that a Chev lasts 16 years in Sweden, as they say about the Volvos in this country.
I can drive my Ford from here back to Ottawa and back again. All I have to do is check the oil and fill it with gas. But you try doing that with a Japanese job.
Is it not a fact, Dennis McDermott, that you have failed? In fact, in September 1980, when I introduced you, you were then telling the nation that you're going to kick the troublesome building trades out of the Canadian Labour Congress. And you did so, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
And you're not going to try and get them back in again. You're just going to raid them.
No, of course we're going to try and get them back in. But it's a matter of agreeing on the terms of reentry. I don't feel good about that. I don't have any rejoicing about them leaving the
In 25
Canadian
words or
Labour
less,
Congress.
Why did you kick them out?
Well, because they took themselves out. We didn't kick them out. They left of their own accord.
Because?
And they were out for over 1 year before we took the formal action of suspension. No, they left. We didn't ask them to leave.
But they weren't paying you the per capita.
We didn't provoke them to leave. That's right.
So you lost all that $250,000.
And the argument that we have there is not with the few hundred thousand workers in the building trades. It's a very small cadre of leadership who have more loyalty to Washington than they do to in their own country.
The dangerous influence of international unionism at its worst.
At its very worst.
No, but I go down to BC Fed Convention yesterday and I see all my old buddies of the Building Trades Council here. They're fraternal delegates, so they're visitors. They're not even allowed in to mix. Doesn't that greatly weaken organized labor in BC?
Of course it does. Of course it does. And the act of them walking out at a very critical time like this when we need unity, the ironic part is in the United States that we criticize a great deal that the unions that were out of the FLCIO, including my own, are now back in. The FLCIO itself is back into the ICFTU. The U.S. is back into the ILO. We're going in the other direction, but that isn't my fault. Isn't the fault of the Canadian Labour Congress. It's because of these bullheaded people who seem to command with great authority in the building trades want to go in the other direction.
Well, couldn't the building trades here come back in separately if they wanted to without reference to the East?
We have a system and we have a structure where they can do that. We're just waiting for them to do it, and I think eventually they will.
Mind you've had your own troubles. Just off the top of my head, I can remember an occasion where machinists crossing the picket lines of, I think it was the ward there. Mm-hmm. You haven't got labor under very good control, and we've had other complaints about CUPE working inside NABIT picket lines. Why didn't you do something about traitors to the working class?
It's a no-win thing. I mean, we don't have that kind of control. We've never had that kind of control. It's the very nature of the Canadian labor movement. And if we were to get that kind of a control, then people would complain because we'd be too authoritarian. No, we can only persuade people to do what we think is right. Mm-hmm. In the case of Ward Air, the machinists had a legitimate argument, they said, for not doing it. I'm not even familiar with the
local one here.
CUPE,
that NABIT was CBC.
Thing.
That was CUPE and NABIT. Mm-hmm. Remember, mm-hmm. NABIT were inside. No, NABIT were out, and CUPE were inside.
Some unions talk about a good fight and do it, and other unions talk about a good fight and don't do it.
Do you remember?
It's the nature of unions.
Don't you think nowadays that because of the affluence of the younger generation, my age is showing, that the younger members of your unions have got no working class solidarity, that they are not, they don't subscribe to trade union principles because they've never suffered. They've had it easy because of your efforts, and under a real test, your whole union organization might collapse if it came to a question of principle.
Jack, that's a wrong scenario. One could assume that, but let me tell you, based on personal experience, the opposite is true. More and more, increasingly, the leadership in local unions, the leadership that are coming into the labor movement are extremely young people, and they have an enormous sense of commitment. Now, maybe that's due to our educational programs and the stuff that we work at very diligently, but my view is the opposite, that the younger people are more committed, they are better educated, and they are there in increasing numbers. You would be surprised at the age of the average delegate to our convention, for example. Mm-hmm. They're getting younger all the time, not getting older. And we worried about that. You know, we always worry about, do they have the same kind of commitment that we had? Well, I don't know. I come out of a very poor neighborhood, and maybe that's where I got my sense of commitment and my sense of direction. But there's a lot of poor neighborhoods around, too, today. At least I had a job when I left school at 14.
But you had to
work. A lot of the kids here don't have a job.
You had to work and you didn't eat. Even if somebody doesn't work nowadays, there's always food from some agency
or
another.
But that's existing, that's not living.
All right.
Don't tell me they enjoy that.
No, I'm not suggesting they do. I'm just saying it's a different social climate. Okay, your target for this year, 1982, hammer the government?
Exactly. This thing that we started on interest rates has got to continue. And I tell you that when 100,000 angry and concerned Canadians demonstrate on Parliament Hill, no political process can afford to ignore that.
And the banks don't dare bring in lots of foreclosures anyway, dare they? They won't show their hand, even if people are miles behind on their mortgages, will they?
Bankers live on another planet, but even they have got to have a degree of sensitivity. They've got to listen to this. And if they don't, then we're going to do it again. And maybe the next time we'll demonstrate inside the House of Parliament instead of outside.
Oh, you mean like Monroe did over at the beach at the legislature? That's a bit
what
tacky,
did he do?
Isn't it? He led 150 well-dressed loggers in and they clomped up and down the stairs. It's a bit tacky.
Well, what I'm prescribing is not going to be tacky. I mean, this is not theatrics.
Are you telling me you're going to occupy the House of Commons?
This is not theatrics. If they will not listen to us outside, then I think they compel us to go inside. Now, it doesn't mean we're going to burn the place down or advocate anarchy or anything like that. But if we can't get their attention with 100,000 people outside, then obviously we've got to do something else. We can't just keel over and say we had a nice demonstration and that's the end of it.
We finally got to the point, and that's perhaps my fault, because I was saying, where are you going after 100,000? You get the television coverage, we'll cover anything. As long as you phone us up and tell us it's going to be a big riot or a little riot, we'll cover it. Now you're telling me, if Trudeau doesn't listen, you'll go much further in physical action against the government.
We have to, because we are apparently the only agency that speaks for the people of Canada who have been hurt by this. And I repeat, not just members of the labor movement, but Canadians from all walks of life. And they desperately need something to be done about this. And if we're the only agency that can do it, with their cooperation, then that's the way we have to go.
Your calls to Dennis McDermott, President of the Canadian Labor Congress, a man determined to do something in this affluent, wealthy country of ours.
Not so affluent, not so wealthy.
Is for some people.
Only some.
After the break. One thing you didn't mention, you're obviously not fearful of legislation. There's not much talk of right to work out here, except for the little old ladies of social credit who sometimes mention it. Bennett himself is against right to work legislation. You've got an NDP government in Saskatchewan, one in Manitoba. That's all, isn't it? Just a two.
Yeah.
Is there any legislation, horrendous, draconian legislation that you're fearful that might come down the pike?
The only fear we had has been obliterated. And that was Sterling Lyons.
Sterling Lyons.
So the Manitoba people retired him.
And now that he's out of the way, I mean, certainly Trudeau wouldn't do anything really nasty to you except to your pocketbook, right?
Well, he's capable of doing nasty things, but I think intellectually he doesn't look at that one at all because it's an absurdity anyway.
I haven't even mentioned Levesque or the Constitution. I presume that you and the Canadian Labour Congress are not any form of power in the province of Quebec, really.
Well, we are through the FTQ, through the Federation.
Oh, Louis Laberge, good friend of yours.
Yes, he is.
He's always on the platform with you.
Yeah?
He's a separatist, Louis, isn't he?
No, I don't think so.
He sounds like a separatist.
So do a lot of Quebecers at times, but I think if you saw that Quebec delegation coming across that bridge on November 21, that was an indication that Quebec is prepared to work with the rest of Canada.
How little I know about Quebec. CNTU, that's the separate organization, isn't it? Confederation National?
Yeah.
That's a Quebec.
That's a Quebec-based.
Nothing to do with you.
Christian-based. It used to be the old Catholic syndicate.
Are they big?
No.
They're not big.
No,
they're
not.
The FTQ is the one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, calls. Go ahead to Brother McDermott.
Okay, yes, Mr. McDermott. In regards to the interest rates, i.e. on mortgages, one thing that I can never understand why they cannot fix that at, say, 11, 12, 13%, and have investors invest money into mortgages for the first home buyer or the second home buyer, whatever, and have that money invested, so therefore it would be out, so it would be a fixed rate, say for 20 years or 25 years, and the invested dollar, the interest obtained on the invested dollar would be tax-free. just like they have civic bonds or municipal bonds in the state.
What do you think of that?
Very, very similar to what they have in the states, and of course that's an intelligent idea.
And one thing about
even though interest rates have come down, that doesn't mean that mortgage rates have come down. Well, mortgage rates are not necessarily tied to interest rates.
And the other thing is that people are juggling about with 6 month, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year mortgages. And the banks were supposed to bring it all back down to the drop in interest rates, and I don't suppose they ever did they?
Well, this is the dramatic part of all this, is the upsetting part, that people have to try and plan their lives economically. And when you have a 25-year mortgage at a fixed rate, then you can do that. But when you have to renew every couple of years and you don't know what's facing you, that brings about this economic disaster that we're facing.
Incomes are a hell of a lot better than they were when mortgage rates were 5, 6, and 7%, aren't they?
I know, but people can only afford to spend so much of their income. They have this strange habit of eating and clothing children and that sort of thing, all of which costs money.
Toronto Dominion Bank sure lowered the boom the other day when they said they were only going to give mortgages on the basis of a maximum of 20% of your gross income.
Yeah. And no one really knows how you get at that anyway.
No. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello.
That's you. Speak up to Dennis McDermott.
I was really impressed by the march on Ottawa last week, and I'd like to ask Mr. McDermott if the Canadian public wants to get involved with the pressure that the CLC is putting on the government, what sort of liaison does the CLC have that one could contact? And
you can call any provincial federation of labor. You can call any office of the Canadian Labor Congress, and we have them all across the land in every province and every major city.
And what are you doing? Petitions?
Well, you can talk to our people, and if we plan an event, we can set up a communication process where we at least will have your name and your phone number, and we can call upon you if we want you.
You won't work beside non-union men on a job, but you'll take their help to fight the government.
Oh, we work beside all kinds of non-union people on the job. It's only certain unions that have that kind of hang-up.
Building trades have that kind of hang-up, too, I believe. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. McDermott, I wonder if the Congress has any policy regarding the flight of Canadian capital, like the way these financial institutions and corporations ship their money out of the country whenever it suits their purpose.
Of course we do. We have said repeatedly, and a lot of the arguments that we have now from the banks is about investors. Well, that's the reason why we have the agency that the Americans are complaining about these days.
FIRA.
FIRA. Exactly. American capital is upset about that. Why? Because they invest, they skim off the cream, they take everything out of the country, they leave nothing here. That kind of investment we don't need.
Go ahead, please.
Mr. McDermott, I would like to say one small little thing in the risk of being a very, very, very minority. We don't need the unions to be government. Now, they want the highest wages on earth and the lowest prices, the lowest mortgage rates, but never a great big down payment for a house. Oh, a couple of $100, you know. And then everybody else is supposed to pick up the tab and help you along. Now, Webster, you needn't grin because it doesn't refer to you. You're in a different category.
I'm just laughing because you're pinning him to the cross.
Well, that's
true. But I'm trying to hold my temper. The lady said I must be rational. And I'm an old-age pensioner who doesn't expect colored plumbing and taxis and things like that to get her around. I manage, and I save, and I invest at 18.25% every little bit I have. And you ask too much. We don't need you to be government. You're getting just a little bit beyond yourself.
We're not asking to be government.
The whole thing is going to fall apart.
With great respect, I think your prejudice is showing.
No,
I mean, that's your hypothesis.
I was in a union, but I wasn't. I was in a union where I had to join, whether I had the choice or not. I was a nurse, and
well, we represent less than a third of wage earners in this country anyway, and we don't propose to monopolize anything. What we're doing here is trying to help the people in Canada. That's the diametric opposite of what you're talking about. You're saying we have a selfish image. What we're doing is very unselfish. What we're doing is providing aid and assistance to people who are not organized, who have no other agency to speak for them.
Mind you, it was a good shot at you. If you want to be government, get elected.
You're asking too much.
Well, that's what we intend to do.
We don't intend
to seize power.
A good call. Not seize power, but you might occupy the House of Commons for an afternoon.
Just to get their attention.
Yeah, hit them over the head with a two-by-four
first.
Get their attention.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Yes.
Mr. McDermott, I agree with your policies. I'm an Albertan, and I'm out here looking for work right now. I can't find work here. I can't find work in Alberta. When Clark was in, everybody was opposed to his excise tax on natural gas and his extra taxes on alcohol and cigarettes. Trudeau was against it. Then when he got in, he turned around and did the same thing. They
exactly.
were playing ping pong ball.
Isn't that political immorality of the worst kind?
Now, he should get out of the gutter and come down to the sewer and address the Canadians and do something about the unemployment situation. As a result of his policies, taking over Clark's policies, he made 350 rigs move out of Alberta to the United States when they could be drilling oil for oil here.
Mm-hmm.
The oil rigs. Okay, boy. That's a new one.
The opposite of what he said he would do.
Get out of the gutter and come down into the sewer with the rest of us. That's a little too colorful. Another segment with Dennis McDermott after the break. I didn't mention equal pay for women. What does it really mean, the likes of your industry? Aren't the women in your industry getting equal pay now?
They are now, but they weren't for a long time. Even when the union was pretty secure in collective bargaining, they didn't get it until the legislative edict came down. That's the value of the legislative
That's
edict.
That's in Ontario.
Mm-hmm.
We have it here. They probably don't have it in some of the eastern maritime provinces.
No, they don't.
But it immediately means, quite simply, equal pay for work of equal value. If there are two salesmen in operation, or two whatever, male and female, same recompense. Mm.
And for the life of me, I don't know why it's debatable.
I don't know what all the fuss is about.
Very simple, civilized, equitable arrangement. I don't know why people quarrel about it and debate it for weeks on end.
Tell you the truth, neither do I. Although, mind you, the clerk typist doesn't get the same as the guy who runs the operation just because she's a woman.
That's not what it means. But if there are two typists, one male and one female, then they get the same rate.
Go ahead, please, to Dennis McDermott.
Yes, Mr. McDermott. First of all, I'd like to congratulate you on your stand in Ottawa. We need someone like you to represent us Canadians who are hardworking people and who are just sitting here at home wondering if we can ever afford to buy a house. Myself, my wife and I both work very hard, and we have a good income, but according to the standards set by the bank, we can't afford a house, and I honestly can't see in the future us being able to afford one. And I can't understand the banks. What they're doing is they're limiting themselves to a certain income of people or a certain percentage of the people. Would it not be wiser for them to lower their interest rates, lower their annual profits, which are horrendous anyway, and knock the interest rates down so more people can afford to buy houses, and therefore you're going to have more of a market to choose from.
Right.
And ultimately, in the end, when you've got the volume, the profit is still going to be there.
Why, you said it all in a few sentences. It is. It's economic idiocy. It's political idiocy. The only people that gain from it are the big investors. You're a classic example. You're gainfully employed, but you're really no better off than the other people that we've talked about that are unemployed, the underemployed, and so on. This is the great tragedy, that even people that are fortunate enough to be gainfully employed cannot plan their economic future. They cannot obtain what should be a basic right in this country, and that is to put a roof over their head.
Of course, the other thing is nobody now expects to be, generally speaking, or will tolerate being poor or at a lower level than the guy next door.
But the economic spinoff, Jack, is that all kinds of people that would normally be gainfully employed because of this economic mess, which is not certainly can't be political gain for them.
No.
Certainly can't be. I mean, there hasn't been one spokesman that said anything good about the McCacken budget, for example. And we have people who should be gainfully employed in the automobile industry, in the farm implement industry. The farmer can't buy the tractor or the combine because he can't pay the interest rates.
One thing
so we have economic recession.
One thing that might make you snicker a little bit is that I can tell you with some authority that the Liberal bagman in British Columbia will get no money for the next federal election.
The Liberal bagman in BC, I think, has a very small purse.
He will. He will have from now on. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Brother McDermott.
Oh. Good morning.
Hi. I'm a supporter of the NDP, but I get really worried about Labour back in a party that doesn't have necessarily a good track record concerning trade union negotiations, such as in British Columbia conditions we had a few years ago, and also in Saskatchewan. But other than that, I guess my question to you is that I really strongly feel that it would be better to place more emphasis and the time and the money on organizing more of the unorganized workers in Canada. I know that in BC here we've had, in the last year or two, the farm workers have been organizing, and the labor movement hasn't touched that sector for years.
Well, you're right. We're trying to do both, of course, but our objective in backing the NDP is because it happens to be the only clear alternative that we have in this country. And of course they don't do everything that we want them to do because they're elected by the people at large. They're not, we don't seek to captivate them or to dominate them or to unnecessarily influence them. Okay. Our purpose in backing the NDP is a social objective, not an economic or a trade union objective.
It's the best at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any problem with great communist domination of any of your unions in the CLC like you used to have when I was a boy?
No, no. No, they've pretty well faded. They're still there, of course, because they are indeed a political, recognized political force in this country, but they're a minority group.
They're no problem for you in the CLC.
Well, they're always a problem because they're very active people.
Got to keep an eye on them.
Yeah.
Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello.
That's you, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. I just have a few words to say. I'd just like to mention that Mr. McDermott and a few more that are running our country to get off their butts and do some work and not sit there and talk. If they want to do something for the people of Canada, get to work.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Otherwise, no comment. Go ahead, please.
Mr. McDermott, I'd like to make some comments, too. I'm a real estate agent, and I believe that I've been listening to the program throughout the whole week regarding housing and high interest rates. Now, I believe that the municipalities are also at fault, too, because they charge these developers these enormous impost fees for subdivisions, for sidewalks, sewers, and lights, which is passed down to the purchasers. Now, when my father and their friends and your people's ages, when you bought a home at 6 and 8%, they were small homes, there were no sidewalks, no light posts, no lift, and you could afford a home. We don't need all these sidewalks and sewers and lights and great big homes to start in. We just want a small home to begin with so that we can move up into bigger homes like you guys.
Good
well,
point.
That's what most people want, I think, a very simple, modest home. But the problem is not with the municipality. Certainly that adds to the cost when you have a more sophisticated service system. But the big problem, and you know that in real estate, and the real estate organizations are speaking out in one voice, that they're being badly hurt mm-hmm. by interest rates. That's the reason why real estate is not taking up. That's the reason, too, why people are not working in housing.
Yeah, a lot of housing is non-union, of course.
You don't have to be an economic genius to figure that out. Well, it doesn't matter whether it's union or non-union, as far as I'm concerned.
You want to see the house he's built? Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. McDermott?
Yeah.
Do you think all the liberals, the night the budget was coming down, knew what was happening to the homeowner? The reason why I asked this is I got a phone call from Paul Cosgrove's office that day, and he led me to believe more than deferred interest rates were coming down.
Yeah, well, no one's really sure whether Cosgrove was ditched on that budget the way that Herb Gray was on his industrial strategy. I must confess, I really don't know what happens up there in that ivory tower. Oh. I find it very hard to believe that they can bring down a budget without at least having consensus among the top hierarchy anyway. Including the Prime Minister.
My own opinion is that when McKechnie read that budget, killing something like $1 billion worth of housing construction across the country, that he didn't know what the words meant.
That's very possible. It was written by a bureaucrat and given to him to read as a script.
And they flip-flopped in 6 days, and when I put it to the Prime Minister the other day, he wouldn't even admit there was a flip-flop. It's unbelievable.
It's incredible, and you know, they did go back. All of the Liberal MPs went back to their own ridings, their own constituencies during the summer recess and tested the waters. And they came back, and that was the issue, interest rates. They went through that incredible by-election in Spadina, which is a very comfortable, safe, ethnic Liberal seat with the hand-picked star, and he was beaten by Dan Heap. Now, that is a clear political message to me, and I'm not a politician.
Not much enough.
I can hear it.
Yeah.
They either heard it and ignored it in their incredible arrogance, or they didn't hear it.
Final
either
question.
Way, it's incredible incompetence.
When's your next march in Ottawa, when you may perhaps occupy the public areas of the House of Commons.
I'm going to sit down with my executive council next week and talk about it.
So it might be before Christmas?
It could be.
More likely after Christmas. What's this here? Yesterday, Kinnaird talked of a general strike. Today, you talk of occupation of the House of Commons. Is there a trend towards law-breaking on the part of you and your union?
No, I don't think so. We're not going to break any laws that I know of, unless they have a law that prohibits entry into the House of Commons. I don't know what Jim said about a general strike. That's been mentioned before. I have to talk to him to find out what he meant by that. But my point is that I am not promoting any general strike at this point for two reasons. A, we have enough people out of work, we don't need more. B, the labor movement is not entirely accountable. Other people have to join with us. We're not going to totally assume responsibility for this economic chaos or responsibility for carrying it. It affects everyone else. Everyone else ought to be in the act.
No general strike foreseen from your point of view, but occupation of the House of Commons as a peaceful protest, a distinct possibility.
That's right.
My thanks to Dennis McDermott. Next to Dave Stupich, the man with the bricks in his hand. After the break. On the telephone from Victoria, I have Dave Stupich, the NDP finance critic and member for Nanaimo. Dave, just a little bit of background. When was it you lost the lawsuit to Mr. Bennett?
Did you say when?
When, yeah.
Oh, it was in August, I think, that the trial was finished.
That was the famous Scotch and Cornflakes libel trial in which you were nailed.
That's right.
What was the judgment against you?
$10,000 was awarded to the premier.
As damages?
I'm not sure of the term. I think it wasn't damages, but in any case, $10,000 was to go to him, and then court costs of somewhere in the neighborhood of $4,500, I believe.
I see. And had any of the money been proffered prior to yesterday?
No. I've been waiting for instructions from my lawyer.
And so yesterday you decided on a plan to pay the debt. Perhaps you could explain it to me.
To pay the $10,000 that was due to the premier. And I had, like many other British Columbians, bought shares in brick when they were first on the market. At that time, they were said to be worth $11. And the premier urged everyone to buy them, not because he was urging, but because I wanted to keep company ownership in BC. I went along with a lot of other people and bought these shares at $6, 5,000 of them.
5,000 shares at $6. You had a $30,000 investment.
That's right.
And you hadn't sold any in the meantime.
No, and I don't intend to sell them. I intend to keep them, apart from the ones I offered to the premier. I intend to keep them.
And how many did you, how many shares did you give to the premier and how did you get them in his hand?
I had the certificate divided into two certificates, one of them for 1,667 shares, which at $6 comes to $10,002.
That's at the issued price which you paid.
That's right.
Right?
Yes. And the remaining certificate is for the 3333 shares. I still have that.
33. And did you give them to Bennett yourself?
I was in a caucus meeting at the time. My secretary handed the share certificate along with a letter of enclosure to Mr. Bennett as he was approaching the legislative chamber just prior to 2 o'clock.
And what happened?
He accepted them. He didn't know what it was at first, I suppose, and then when he realized what it was, he went into the legislative chamber, and after question period, he came and sat beside me and told me he was giving them back to me because his understanding was that the award had to be paid into court.
Is he right?
Well, I talked to three lawyers, and they all say that's not the case in a civil case, that it can be handled directly between the people involved, that the court is, as one lawyer said, functus. The court has no more role in this, having come down with the award.
So therefore, what you were doing was you were giving him 1,667 shares at the issued price of $6, equaling $10,002.
That's right.
But on the market, at the premier, he gave them back to you, did he?
He handed the certificate back to me, yes.
And on the market, however, if he'd kept them or if you'd sold them yesterday, you would have got how much?
I believe they hit a new low of 315, I think it was. So at that rate, it would be something like $5,500, roughly.
Which wouldn't have been settlement. Anyway, you did this as a very astute political publicity ploy. Is that not correct?
Well, partly that, but partly Mr. Bennett did father this corporation. He did recommend to people that they buy them at $6, and I wouldn't expect him to say they were worth any less. I think they're worth more than that. I don't accept the market's evaluation of them. BRIC has the resources, it has the assets, and as soon as the forest industry turns around, I'm quite positive they'll be worth more than $6. They're worth more now. The market isn't ready to pay that, but they're worth it.
Yeah, the breakdown value is more than that.
Oh, yes. Sure.
However, you gave him his gold bricks and he snubbed you and he handed them back to you. When will you give him the $10,000 in real Canadian money?
Well, once again, I'm waiting for instructions from my lawyer. And when my lawyer says it's time to write a check, then I'll write a check.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stupich. And I understand that Mr. Bennett, to reporters, didn't think it was a very funny idea on your behalf.
He seemed to be quite affable about the whole thing when he talked to me.
But he gave them back. Thanks very much, Davy. That's a good way to make page one. I'm much obliged.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, after this, I'm going to have a free-for-all. Now, I'm quite serious about having a free-for-all about the specific land claims made by the Squamish Indians and that would appear, too, by the Musqueam Indians on the program last week. You may have noticed on the clip I played earlier this morning how I was somewhat taken aback. Now, I may be a simpleton. I may be simple-minded. But despite the validity of many Aboriginal rights and claims, which obviously exist in this country, and despite the confusion of existing rights, as is in the Section 34 of the Constitution, I just had to say to both to Joe Mathias especially, you gotta be joking, don't be daft. You're not gonna get Stanley Park, you're not gonna get BC Place, you're not gonna get, although I didn't mention it particularly, the stadium, and very unlikely you're going to get UBC. Okay, lines are clear, I'm clear. Does anyone take these Indian claims seriously? I mean, apart from the Nuchinalth, they wanting 4,400 square miles on the west coast of Vancouver Island, and 50% of all the resources of the sea out to the 200-mile limit. And also, if you saw that program, you'd realize that the Nuchinalth are also claiming all the ecological control, the hunting, the mineral rights, the timber, on some basis, on a large part of Vancouver Island. And I have no doubt it'll only be a question of time until various tribal groups lay claim to the whole of British Columbia, which is, you know, reductio ad absurdum, as somebody once said. You'll remember, too, that I had Bob Warren on last week, speaking for the United Native Nations. And his claim was quite simple. There are 100,000, he claims, disenfranchised Indians and Métis in British Columbia, and they are entitled to a share of the lolly. It's a very tricky one, but obviously the provincial premiers wanted the Aboriginal rights out of the Constitution for this very one reason. They don't want to get nailed with any valid land claims that are going to cost the provincial governments masses of money. Not even Blakeney wanted it. Bennett didn't want it. Bennett collapsed on it at the end and said, okay, I'll give in on Section 34, providing the federal government decides to reimburse everyone involved, the provincial government involved, for all the money exchanged. So I want to do a very fairly short, sharp, clipped poll on the topic after this break. Private joke, none to the topic. Do you think the Indian land claims to Stanley Park, False Creek, BC Place, UBC are valid? Do you treat them seriously at all? Because take my word for it, the Indians are serious. They are not joking, even though that was my instant response. How do you answer? Hello?
Are you speaking to me?
Yes, Gladys. I've got the phones. Where do I go? Yes, I'm speaking to you, ma'am. Yes, go ahead. That's you, ma'am.
Me?
Yes.
Regarding the validity of the claim, I don't really take it seriously at all. And it's not a question of not having empathy for the Aboriginal peoples of this country. It's just simply a case of if this claim is valid, then do they get the lands back with all the improvements that everybody has made?
Who knows, ma'am, but your answer is clear. Go ahead, please.
Absolutely not. They also want 4,000 square miles of the west coast of British Columbia.
That's only one claim for one small group of 6,000 Indians.
Yeah, but the fact is, as far as I'm concerned, no. That means that we have two types of citizens, one the privileged and one the unprivileged.
Fair enough. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
How do you feel about it?
Look, anybody that has title to certain properties has certain responsibilities. And all of these titles to the 200-mile limit, etc., were negotiated through taxes that were collected from the taxpayers to protect these titles. Now, if they want title to all of these things, I think that they should. I think that the government picks up less taxes.
Your answer is obviously no, even though you're confused about it. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
How do you answer the question? Do you take the Indian claims seriously?
I think so.
You take them seriously?
Oh, yes.
You're prepared to give them...
I think our school books are a way out. We always talk about the two founding nations, but never talk about the ones that were founded.
Fine, fair enough. Your father claims. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I don't know why in this country we would have these two types of people. The Indians with their special rights...
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, in other words, you're recognizing divine right of a certain class of people, that's Indians. If you have two babies born in the hospital today in this country, you have the inequality of Canadians who are non-Indians. They have no rights to these lands and these special privileges, and then you have the Indians. It doesn't seem to me to be the type of thing we'd have in a democratic society.
Yeah. The position... You've got to look at the position quite simply and indeed. Way back in the 18th century, when the Anglo-Saxon white man first came to this country, he made certain treaties with certain Indians in certain bands in eastern Canada on the prairies. There were very few, if any, treaties in British Columbia. Reserves were recognized. Now, reserves, there may well be a valid legal claim, as in the Nisga case. There may well be a valid legal claim, as there is in the Squamish case. But I wanted to spotlight this morning and put it quite straightforward to everyone. When Joe Mathias and the others tell me with a straight face, and they mean it, that they really mean to make a claim on Stanley Park and BC Place and UBC and the stadium and the rest of it, it becomes quite incomprehensible and doesn't make any sense. In addition to that, of course, the Indians' line now is that they want the $1 billion that's spent every year on Indian affairs, much of which I'm sure has not been well spent in the years past, and they want that into their hands to do with as they will. How far back do you go to Aboriginal peoples? Doesn't make any sense. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Webster. I'd like to know, where do they get off to say that it's their land? I thought our forefathers fought for this land years and years and years ago. And it just, it's, if you're a Canadian, it's everybody's land. And they should just go along with, like everybody else, as Canadians and be done with it. I don't think they got any more rights than anybody else. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm inclined to agree with you. Go ahead, please. How about you?
Is that me?
That's
yes,
you.
I do take the Indians seriously on this. But I take them seriously at this level, that this is the beginning of a bargaining position. You were just talking to a union man. You don't expect him to put his final claim on the table when he begins. And what the Indians want, as far as I can make out, is some kind of compensation for what was taken away from them, only quasi-legally.
Well, if they start on a reasonable basis, they will be dealt with seriously. If they start on an unreasonable basis, they will spoil their chances for a reasonable basis.
No, I don't agree with you. Their claims are so enormous that they have to start in order to be heard.
Have they
valid? Hitting them over the head with a 2x4 in order to be heard at all, because they've been being reasonable for a long time.
I see. Thank you, ma'am. There are how many Indians in British Columbia? I think it's 100,000 non-status, according to Bob Warren, although I think his figures are high. And I'm not sure about the figure of status Indians in British Columbia. The figure of 65,000 comes to mind, but I'm not quite sure on that. Population, the other population, indigenous population, if you like to call it, is 2.5 million. And it's just ludicrous to think of handing back all the assets which have been built up since CPR came in here on a claim to a local Indian tribal group. Go ahead, please. What are you? Is that eight?
Hello?
That's you, sir. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I think that we have to recognize the BC Indians' claims, or any Indians' Aboriginal claims to land, seriously, because we recognize fundamentally in law, through tradition and prior use, the right to use land and to occupy it and to lay claim to it. We would not, if we embrace the principle of stripping people of land through force, I don't think that that's a very democratic procedure.
So therefore your position is that the Indians are entitled to, to claim the whole land mass of all of British Columbia?
They're entitled to claim all those areas of which they occupied and had control through economic activity. That means the travel around them or over them and the uses of the resources within all their traditional areas.
Thank you, sir. When are you leaving the country?
Pardon?
When are you leaving the country?
I'm not leaving the country.
Good. Thank you. Go ahead, please, from Black Creek.
Yes, Jack.
Where is Black Creek?
I've been trying to get hold of you for 100 years on this Aboriginal business. I think it's the biggest con job that ever happened to the province of B.C. or to Canada, as far as that's concerned. I'm about 3 years older than you are, Jack, and I was raised with Native Indians up in the north, and I've been down on the coast here. I've fished amongst these guys. I've done the whole shebang, and it's a great big con job.
Thank you, sir. He regards it as a con game. Go ahead, please. Go ahead. Oh, break time? Good.
Hello?
I'll take you and then I'll go to break. What do you say, sir? That's you.
Me?
Yes.
Well, the problem I have seeing is where do our obligations start and end? Are we only obligated to the direct descendants, in other words, pure Indians originally, Aborigines, or
no,
to the offspring of marriages?
No, that was one of the things that upset me a little bit the other day when they start to talk about bloodlines. And if your grandmother was an Indian, you qualified to the claims. Quarter blood. You begin to have that uneasy feeling that there was in Germany when Jews were defined by if their grandmother was Jewish, they were Jewish, and as such went to a concentration camp. And it's quite intolerable that we should suddenly have a great ethnic rush on. Hey, where did Granny come from? Hey, Granny was an Indian. Hey, let's go for 100 acres of Stanley Park. She lived there. After the break. Okay, now, I'm not trying to cause trouble. I'm just trying to bring some sanity back into the debate on Aboriginal rights. Because so often, the Indian spokesmen, who are financed in many ways, or were financed many times in many ways, including the Denny Nation Declaration, by federal funds from the Secretary of State, who supplied all the monies for the lobbying because of their lack of expertise in the white man's society. And so often, people who interview spokesmen for Aboriginal rights merely say, yes, 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 free bags full. When it came up the other day on the question of Stanley Park, the stadium, BC Place, UBC, I couldn't, and I still can't resist a laugh. Now, I may be daft. On here is Bill Wilson. Bill, is this Bill Wilson or Bill Williams?
Williams.
Oh, where are you speaking from, Bill? Squamish?
Yes.
Okay, Bill, what do you think of my attitude this morning?
Well, I think it's very typical of a lot of non-Indians. One of the biggest problems dealing with Indian land claims is that we want a recognition of rights, not necessarily taking over the total territory and kicking people out.
Well, you couldn't possibly do that anyway, and you know it.
I know that, yeah. And but the people today, they don't look at, when they say land claims, they figure they're take over the whole area. We don't want to take over all of BC completely.
You just want to own it.
We already do that. We just want to...
No, you don't own it already. I mean, let's get it quite clear. The occupiers of this land since the 18th century established certain rules and laws and whatnot and created titles of land which rightly or wrongly they gave to themselves and their descendants.
Mm-hmm.
And the recognition of native rights are those rights, I suppose, which were not stolen by the invader, which have been the traditional usage and
areas of those Indians. But you can't expect any normal taxpayer to say, the land belongs to you and we're only borrowing it from you. But he's not going to say that. And even if his court said, he ain't going to.
Yeah. Well, one of the biggest problems is that your government has manipulated and used the rules and regulations to kick people out of areas such as Stanley Park in the case of Squamish Band. We had band members living there, you know, all the time. Then they were asked to leave, and the land was designated as a park, and we couldn't go back there again.
That's right. I was there when the last Indian, he wasn't really an Indian, he was married to an Indian princess, was living in Stanley Park, and I remember that kind of sad little day. But that is part of the city of Vancouver, and it's a deeded federal park of 1,000 acres. It was originally a reserve by the British Admiralty, forbid the mention of the colonial power.
But how did the British Admiralty get it? They had to.
British Admiralty took it as right of invasion, a right of conquest, and you're stuck with it.
Right.
It's as simple as that.
But there was no battle fought.
No which?
No battle.
No, they just occupied it. They took it.
So how can you have it by right of invasion if there's no battle and there's no treaty signed or nothing?
Right of occupation. I mean, you've got to face the facts of life, Willie. You just can't kid yourself that because you make a claim that the courts are going to say, okay, 150 Indians stayed here for maybe 210 years, we're now going to give it back to them. They won't do it.
I think it's a bit longer than 210.
Well, whatever it is, I'm only picking a figure. All I'm saying is that it's perfectly well to recognize established using rights, but as in the McBride thing in 19, whenever it was, in West Vancouver, 19. Where they tore up the treaty once and then they had to reset it and
there
give
no
you...
There was no treaty there.
There was an agreement.
There wasn't even an agreement.
Well, what was the McBride Commission then?
The government and federal government, yes, but not between the Indians.
But there was a decision by which the land was given back entitled to the Squamish Band.
Not yet.
Well, I can remember 400 acres on which you've built right at this very moment. Remember the fuss about the building that wasn't going to comply with the local bylaws?
I'm granting
there are rights, but I'm saying that for somebody to tell us that they're going to take Stanley Park and BC Place and all the rest of it is nonsense.
What we're saying is what we want is a definition of tribal area recognition.
Well, maybe you're entitled to that, but you're certainly not entitled to Stanley Park, BC Place, UBC, or the stadium, and I must leave it at that. Go ahead, please.
Hello, me?
Yes.
Okay, if we assume that they have rights, and we have to determine how many there are eligible, and I don't know if you remember that article that Marsha McLuhan wrote a few years ago about the amount of Indian blood that there is in Canada, especially in Quebec, and three prominent people he named were Trudeau, Lalonde, and Claude Ryan. Where do we end?
Never. Never. Goes on forever.
Well, I can't buy a deal like that.
Neither can I.
It's too hazy.
All I'm saying is that somebody better say something sometime down the road. I remember once when I had a spokesman for one of the Indian, powerful Indian groups from either the Northwest Territories, the Yukon. And he says to me, if you put a gas pipeline to supply gas to the lower mainland of British Columbia, we'll blow it up. And I said to him, what do you think we're going to be doing? We being the society that needs the gas. What do you think we're going to be doing if you blow up the pipeline? The majority in this country tend to allow themselves to be trampled on almost endlessly. And we've been trampled on in some areas by all the constitutional caper. But a time comes when even the placid, flabby, working class or middle working class or non-establishment ordinary man in the street finally gets up from in front of his television set, crumples his beer can and says, enough is enough. Let's talk plain something or other. After the break. Well, how to win friends and influence people. I'm merely talking about the fact that a leading spokesman for the Indians in British Columbia told me on the air the other day, and I didn't take them seriously then, but they're deadly serious, that they want, among their Aboriginal rights, Stanley Park, BC Place, UBC, the stadium,
And while they haven't claimed it yet, they're almost bound to claim the whole of downtown Vancouver. What are your views on it?
I don't know, Jack. I think it's pretty ridiculous, if you ask me. I just can't see anything that is truly believable in anything they ask. First of all, if they're interested in $1 billion every year, I feel if they feel that money is growing on trees, I think they should subdivide the reservations that they're living on now. That ought to give them a few billion when they need it.
They also want the $1 billion in addition.
Well, they don't pay taxes on their land right now, Jack. I'm not too sure, but I'm pretty sure about that. I don't think they pay any taxes on their land when they're doing any work, similar construction work of any sort like that. They don't pay any income tax.
Anyway, your attitude is...
They have a hard time.
Your attitude is much the same as mine.
Well, it's nuts.
Go ahead, please.
It's really a form of reverse discrimination, isn't it? And as such, a throwback to the days when non-Indians were the ethnic group who had to circle their wagons and have their buglers sound out General Assembly.
Well, we never had to do that here. Go ahead, please.
Jack, why doesn't Joe claim Grouse Mountain? It's a losing proposition. Said he's claiming the profitable deals. We'll have to put the tolls back on the bridges that the white men built and charge them tolls, otherwise they'll have to get their canoes and go across to Stanley Park.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead, please.
I'm waiting for the talk line.
That's you.
Hello.
Yep.
You're talking about the rights for Stanley Park?
Yep.
Well, my dad was an original on the land that lived there. He was 14 years old when they moved him off Stanley Park into North Vancouver. And I believe that he has some rights, too, besides what they're talking about, because they moved him out without nothing.
Well, he must be dead now, is he?
No, my dad's still alive.
How old is he? He's an Indian, is he?
Oh, yes, he's Indian.
Well, perhaps you'll get a share of the pot. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yep.
Hello, there's one question that keeps coming up in my mind, and you alluded to it several times. Did the original Indians actually own the land that they settled? And this is going back to what their views of owning land were. To me, they seemed to just use the land, and they didn't have any concept of ownership. And now they're coming back, well, I don't know, 200 years later, and saying that they actually own the land, using the laws that the Europeans have set up. Originally, they don't have any real proof that they own the land.
I'm no authority on it. I merely say that there was a communal use and ownership of the land in a very democratic, I think, manner. Although sometimes in some of the tribal councils in British Columbia, some of the Indian land has slipped out by certificate of possession into the owners of specific individuals. But I don't think that applies down here. But as you say, they want to use the white man's title system to make specific claim to specific land, which their forebears used, hunted on, lived on, and traveled through at some time in the past. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I think we need Grace McCarthy in the Indian Affairs, because everybody else is getting cut back. I think that they should too. And also, they say that they want both sides of the street. They want, you know, their new homes, they want this, they want that, but yet they also want everything else. Now, I think they should either have...
One or the other.
I think they should have one or the other, yes.
So do I. Go ahead, please.
Is this line 8?
That's you.
Hi. You know, Mr. Webster,
mm-hmm.
you haven't taken Pierre Trudeau seriously, or the Canadian people, not you directly, but the Canadian people haven't taken Trudeau seriously for 12 years. Now, all of a sudden, you're getting really worried about the Indians.
No, I'm merely trying to be...
You should have taken that seriously in the first place and use that as priority. This thing is, you know, you're blowing it way out of proportion. The Indian is not going to be a detriment to the Canadian society. I don't know why.
Well, of course he isn't. Who said he was?
Well...
You keep your prejudice to yourself. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I think the Indians can have Stanley Park if they're willing to give up central heating, alcohol, and four-wheel drives.
Well, that applies to more than the Indians.
Land.
I'm much obliged. Anyway, there it is. A little plain speaking, right or wrong. After the break. There's going to be a very special performance at the Queen Elizabeth Theatre on December the 18th, in which I myself am taking part. It is the Famous People Players,
Do you remember the young adult retarded we had on the air and who put on that sparkling show in North Vancouver last year? This year they're bringing back another show, and they're going to perform their Blacklight Magic on a one-night Christmas special, December the 18th, at the Queen Elizabeth Theatre, and accompanied by the Vancouver Symphony Orchestra, and yours truly is scheduled to do the narration over this wonderful work by these youngsters. I want to sell the place out, or help to anyway. $10 per adult for a ticket, $5 per child. One night only on December the 18th. Tickets are Vancouver Ticket Center and Eaton Stores. And it's the famous people players, the invisible puppeteers, bringing their magnificent magic to a one-night Christmas special. And this may help remind you of who and what they are.
Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul on fire. Got a whole lot of money that's ready to burn, so get those stakes up higher. There's a thousand pretty women waiting out there. They're all living the devil may care. And I'm just a devil with love to spare. So Viva Las Vegas, Viva Las Vegas. How I wish that there were more than 24 hours in the day. Even if there were 40 more, I wouldn't sleep a minute away. Oh, there's blackjack and poker and a roulette wheel. A fortune won and lost on every deal. All you need is a strong heart and a nerve of steel.
Viva Las Vegas! Viva Las Vegas!
Las Vegas with your neon flashing and your one-arm bandits crashing all those hopes down the drain. Fever Las Vegas turning day into nighttime, turning night into daytime. If you see it once, you'll never be the same again. I'm gonna keep on the run, I'm gonna have me some fun. If it cost me my very last dime, if I wind up broke, well, I'll always remember that I had a swing in time. I'm gonna give it everything I've got. Lady luck, please let the dice stay hot. Let me shoot a